Hi, I'm Shannon Egli. I'm the anatomical coordinator here at Jump Simulation, and I'm also a clinical associate of anatomy at the University of Illinois College of Medicine. What we're going to do is an experiment where we try and catch some microbes that are in your environment. We call these ubiquitous bacteria, ubiquitous microbes, because they're everywhere. Places you think that they might not be, but they are there. So we're going to try and catch them, grow them so that we can see them with the naked eye. What is a microbe? Microbes are microscopic biological organisms. They're microscopic because you can't normally see them with the naked eye. There are some microbes that you can see that are bigger, like a slime mold that's one cell, but it can actually grow over a meter in size. Kind of cool. There are some fungus that can grow over a mile wide, and we still consider those microbes. We use microbes every day. We use them to make things like yogurt. So we put bacteria in milk to make yogurt. We use them to make bread. So yeast can grow bread. They're all over the place. You may not think about them, but they're in a lot of the foods that you eat all the time, and a lot of the things that you touch or breathe all the time too. So some of the tools that you're going to need, we're going to use some cheese. You can use bread. You can look for a recipe to make an actual Petri dish down below using some gelatin and some chicken broth or bouillon cubes. But with the cheese, these are kind of handy because, well, number one, they're not real cheese. They're made with the ideal things that are in a Petri dish. And a Petri dish is just one of these. These Petri dishes are the ideal environment because they have the proper nutrients. A bacteria is a lot like you, except one cell, but we're multicellular. This one cell has to eat, it has to breathe, it has to keep moist. So one of the things you want to make sure that they're in this are nutrients. Whether you use gelatin with chicken broth, just like if you're making chicken noodle soup for yourself, you're making it for microbes, or if you're using the cheese, which has a lot of different milk proteins and milk sugars and milk nutrients in it. So another benefit to this is that it provides nutrients, but it also is a sterile environment, which is hard to do at home a lot of times, but they have to create it sterile in the lab or factory, like we work in the lab, and they wrap it so that it doesn't grow any fungus or bacteria before you get a chance to peel it and open it and eat it. So you're going to use as many pieces as you want, but I would ideally start off with about 6 slices. And you're going to need some Ziploc bags. One of the important things when you open this, you want to try and keep it down, because whether you realize it or not, around you in 1 cubic meter, so about 3 feet by 3 feet by 3 feet, mold spores, there are over 1 million spores just floating around you all the time that you're breathing in and digesting, or your immune system's fighting. So if I open this piece of cheese and left it on the counter and kept it moist, it would probably start growing mold in a couple days too. The problem is that if I don't put it in a Ziploc bag, it doesn't stay moist, which is one of the rules we need with a Petri dish. So when we open this, and normally I would say clean your hands, put gloves on, but our experiments are actually testing how filthy and nasty your hands are, so I'm gonna keep my hands dirty for this situation. But when you open it, you don't wanna touch your skin to anything on the cheese. So start with the bag. Like I said, when I open it, I just crack it like this, and I'm opening it downward. And it's hard not to get air that has spores inside of it, but I'll open it, and stand it up. Keep it down as much as you can. When you open this, our first slice of cheese is a control, and a control is one that you don't do anything to. So this is a normal piece of cheese, but you have to put it in an environment like all the other test subjects. So whatever we test and we put it in that environment, this piece of cheese has to stay the same way. So if we want to study something and how it changes, we want to know how it changes compared to all the other ones that we do affect. It's part of the scientific method. I'm going to peel the cheese open. I'm going to make sure my finger doesn't touch the cheese. I can touch the wrapper, but not the cheese. Sometimes it's tricky. Pinch a little bit, peel it open. Still not touching the cheese. My finger's still touching the plastic, not the cheese. I'm gonna open this up, slide it in. I'm just gonna flop it over and let it drop. Is it perfectly flat? Nope, I don't care. All right, I'm gonna open the bag so it has a little bit of air in it and run my finger along. So will this be perfectly ideal sterile environment inside the bag? Nope, because as soon as we opened it and we pulled any air in, it pulled some of those bacteria or the fungus spores in with it. But it has air. The moisture that's in the bag is going to stay in the bag, which keeps our subject or our cheese moist. Set that to the side, that's our control. Whatever environment we put this cheese we're experimenting with it in, we have to put this with it too. So for our second piece of cheese, we want to use our dirty, filthy hands on things that we touch all the time. You can choose what you touch. When I came into the lab, I didn't put gloves on like I noticed before. I grabbed door handles, I've touched this table, I've touched a lot of things that actually in the lab we have to wipe down after everything we do. So it's all been sanitized one time, even the door handles, but it's been a few days. So grabbing everything again gave a chance for things to settle on it, or other people I didn't know were coming into the lab with that door handle, so some of their germs or bacteria. And I'm gonna open this the way I did the other one. I open it facing down. So I don't pull anything I don't want in. Minimize germs going into it. And if I can stand it up, I will. Yay, that one stood. Now with this one, I'm going to open it exactly the same way as the last. So you always do everything just like you did with control. You only change one factor. In this situation, I'll show you where it is. I open cheese. Not touching the cheese itself. Feeling. Oops, throw my bag. Still touching just the plastic. And if you contaminate and you touch the cheese, you have to throw it out, otherwise your experiment will bust. I'm gonna put this in. I'm gonna flip it upside down just like I did the last one. Pull out. But this time, my hand is contaminated. I'm gonna put my fingers pressed down firmly. Not to smash the cheese, it's already flat. But just to get some germs on there. Seal it up like we did the last bag, keeping some air in there. You want to keep the moisture. And the temperature that you're going to keep it at, you're going to keep it around 90 degrees. So in the hot summer, it's great for that. If you have a room that's not close to 90, you might want to put a light in that room. Or if you have an aquarium that's empty you're not using, you can put a light in the aquarium and put the cheese in with it. If you want to put it anywhere, in your kitchen, in the closet, somewhere that's going to be warm, just don't stick it in sunlight, because sunlight, UV radiation, can actually kill the bacteria and the fungus. So we want to keep this in any environment that's going to be about 90 degrees. We have the control, we have the dirty fingers, we have the water washed fingers, we have the soapy water washed fingers, and then we have the hand sanitizer fingers. And this is really a good spread, but if you have 24 cheese slices in a pack, why not just use them all, is what I think. So grab some more bags and you can do different things, like where else can you find germs? Well, when we breathe. So here's a really good one that you can experiment with. You can open the bag, like we have before, put the slice of cheese in, and before you seal it shut, blow into it. Now seal it shut. Because once you've taken that deep breath, you pull everything down into your lungs, you're blowing a sample of everything that's in your lungs, in your airway. So whatever's in your trachea, whatever's in the back of your nose, whatever's in the top of your nose, going through your nose hair, whatever, you're blowing it out. So this is a good example to show when you cough or when you sneeze, those particles that are in you, what's coming out. So do you sneeze perfectly clean air, or do you sneeze germs on other people or bacteria or viruses? So we'll sample that one. What you're going to do is you're going to let this grow. So the next important thing for incubation of a bacteria or a mold is you have to let it grow for a certain amount of time. Even though it's already there, you can't see with the naked eye, but bacteria and fungus like to grow in colonies, which means that when they replicate, they work together. You're a multicellular organism and you have trillions of cells that depend on each other all the time. These colonies, they could be independent, but they like to work in little groups, like little families or even little cities, and they grow, and when they grow, to hundreds of thousands, that's when you can usually see them growing on something. So we're going to let this grow for about 2 days. If you don't see anything in 2 days, as long as your cheese is still moist and the environment hasn't been broken, you can go for 3 or 4 or 5 or as long as you need. You can do the same thing with the bread. Make sure that the temperature stays consistent. So if you have a room that's getting cooled off, you might have to put 2 lamps in it or put it closer to some kind of a heat source. I know it's really hard to do in the summertime in the house with the air conditioning. But what we're ideally doing is trying to get these microbes to replicate in the perfect environment. And what they do is, when you start with one, all it takes is one microbe, and by binary fission, they split themselves in half and you have two. And then those two become four. And those four become eight. And then 16, and 32, and 64. And math keeps going higher than I want to replicate. But what's funny is that in 20 minutes, one bacteria can become two. So in 10 hours, you could potentially have over a million bacterial cells growing on a colony. If you want to make a lot of money, you can actually ask your parents to give you a penny today, and then tomorrow give you twice as much, and then the day after twice as much, and see how long it takes to get you a nice big bank account too. But that's a really good example of how fast things can grow and they replicate, just doubling. So after you've seen what your hands have touched and what your hands can grow because of how you're spreading germs, and where it's probably most applicable is actually with the COVID-19 situation that's going on around us. People wonder, why do I have to wear a mask? And it's not so much just because of protecting themselves. In fact, it's more about protecting the public around you. Because when you do an experiment like this and you show that your breath can grow bacteria and fungus, viruses like the COVID-19 virus are the same way. When you cough or sneeze or even breathe on something, it only takes about 20 minutes for a lot of those things to replicate. So the virus gets into the cell, and 20 minutes later you have two cells that are infected with the virus. And then 40 minutes later you have four cells, and then eight cells, and then 16, and then within a day you can have millions of cells that are infected with the virus. And in fact, you can be spreading that virus at the same time that you're replicating them without having any symptoms. So when people say, well, I don't have a fever or whatever, it's not about the fever. The fever is a sign that you are showing it, but it doesn't mean that you aren't infected with it. So when you wear a mask, it's actually more for public safety, not just personal safety. So, it's polite to actually wear masks like this. So hopefully you've learned a lot of things. You've had a lot of actually moments that you can share with people and say, actually, I wear a mask because of this reason, or actually, I don't stick my finger in the cheese for that reason. That's kind of what we want to have you take home, or the actually moments. So thanks for playing, and have fun with your experiment. Let us know how it goes.